After church, or shoot me an email, or give me a call during office hours, and we can talk through any concerns you have with that. Our church conference is going to be on November 6th this year. It is going to be on Zoom. The link will be going out this week. Please mark your calendars. This is where we set our intentions, our budgets, our programming, all of those important things, all of those administrative things for all of 2022. So if you can join us, it should take about an hour, maybe even a little bit less. I will also send out reminders the day before because I know Zoom links get lost in the email pretty easily, at least mine do. It is not too late to join our book club. All of the chapters are standalone, so if you've been enjoying the sermon series, which hopefully you have been, or if you've just thought about joining the book club, you could just read the chapter on salt for this week, and you could join us. We have wonderful discussions. It has been a real blessing to me, and hopefully to all of those who have joined it. Finally, you may have noticed we are having one of our handbell groups this morning. And we just want to thank them for their music ministry. But also, I know that they are still looking for another ringer. So you do not have to be able to read music. You do not need to have played handbells before. If when you hear them, you're like, wow, that's beautiful, you can do it because Sue can help you. So please, Sue is up front. If you've ever thought about joining our handbell choir, this is a great time to do it. It's a great way to learn a fun new musical skill. And here's Pastor Jim with the rest of our announcements.
I highly recommend bell ringing. I had been a bell ringer for many years, and I don't read music. So if you're thinking, I can't read music, I can't ring bells, yes, you can. It's very possible. So give it a shot. So, primary announcement from me this week is trunk or treat. We've picked up a few trunks, mostly thanks to Chris Horner signing up like all of her children. Could you get some of the boys this time? But we could use three or four more trunks, and we need some folks to run children's games. The great thing about trunk or treat has been that we connect with families where we have enough time to have meaningful engagement, right? So if we just have trunk or treat, imagine this, you go trunk 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, kids are done getting their candy, it's over, they go. But if we have games, pumpkin painting, pennies in the hay, all of those fun games, then families stay around and they get connected and we have opportunity to have conversations. So I'd love to have some folks help lead a game or to oversee the moon bounce. That's another way you could help. So next Sunday, October 24th, from 2 to 4, trunk or treat, please think about signing up. I'd love to get you connected. Second announcement, we had an outstanding team of folks go out for the Annandale Crop Hunger Walk yesterday. If you participated in the walk, would you please stand up? So if you see any of these folks and you'd like to help donate to the cause of fighting global and local hunger, 25% of all funds will stay here and support ACA, and 75% of funds will go for global hunger concerns. You can see any of them, write a check for CWS Crop, and if you can't remember that, they'll tell you. give them a check today or next week, and we'll make sure that that money gets to Crop Walk. So thank you so much. Please remember to sign the cards out there today. Thank you.
And now let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship as we lend ear to our prelude.
Let us join together in the call to worship. We gather together to share in the praises of our creating God. We come to tell each other how wonderful our awesome God is. God's creative spirit draws us together to share in worship and praise of our Almighty God, who continues to breathe life into all creation. Let us pray. Lord, everywhere we look, we see the imprint of your creative love. The wondrous works of nature show your majesty. As we gather together to celebrate your love and creation, keep us mindful that we are a part of the created order, meant to be stewards and not destroyers. Prepare us to work for your ministry. Peace and justice. Amen. Let us now affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
As the bells prepare to play, please turn to your neighbor and say, "It's great to see you in church today." Thank you. I'd like to invite the children and all who are feeling young at heart today to come forward for our moment with children. You're sitting over there because that's where we have. Come on.
Look at all these bells.
All right. So let me know if you can see what's on this tray right here. Pretzels. Raise your hand if you've ever had a pretzel. All right. All right. Holloway, come a little bit closer if you would. Come in. Come here, Holly. All right, Holly, you see little white dots on there? What are these little white dots?
Salt.
Salt. That's right. Good. You get an extra prize today. You can have one of these afterward. Okay, you can go back and sit down. Well, the question, I'll answer that at the end of the children's message. These pretzels. Delicious, right? And they're covered with salt, more delicious, right? So why do you think we put salt on pretzels? Oh, I'm being filmed by Hannah here. Amelia, why?
They'll taste better.
That's, well, it depends on who you are if it's good for you. But to anyone out there that's saying salt is not good for me, guess what? If you had no salt in your body, your heart would stop going, right? You would die, as Amelia said. So salt is important to us. And as we've heard, salt gives things flavor. And I think salt just makes a lot of things better. And flavor is one of those things. So in today's gospel story from Matthew, Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth." Can we say that together? You are the salt of the earth. Turn to somebody beside you and say, "You are the salt of the earth." Thank you. So are you. All right. Is that weird? Is that weird to call somebody salt? Jesus is talking to his followers, and guess what? You guys are Jesus' followers, and he's saying, "You are salt." So if salt makes things better, how can you, as a Jesus follower, be salty? How can you make things better in the world? All right, raise your hand. I'll start with a few kids and maybe a few adults. How can you make things better in the world? Go, Carter. He's thinking real hard. I see smoke coming out of his ears. All right, raise your hand if you think you could say something that you could do to make the world better. All right, Amelia. That's right, you could be kind to someone. What did you say? Yes, Robert said, be nice. We could use a lot of being nice these days, couldn't we? So much stress in the world right now. All right, what else? Give me one more example. Yeah, Carter.
Hello.
Yeah, tell people about Jesus, right? Good one. Carter's got it going on today. So we could be nice. We could forgive people. We could help people. We can tell people about Jesus, right? That is how you can be a salty kid. That's how you can be salty grown-ups. I want you to be salty people, all right? Let's pray together. Now, to answer that question that came up, we're going to make salted caramel pretzel sticks at Praise Kids today. Sorry, guys.
Grown-ups, you have to stay for service.
Let's pray, and all God's children are welcome to pray. Dear God, help us to be salty people, sharing your love wherever we go. Amen. All right, let's go to Praise Kids. I know you do.
The first reading today is from Colossians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6, and that's on page 1167 in your pew Bible. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone.
Our New Testament, our gospel reading comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 16. That's found on page 958 of your pew Bible. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Lord, open our hearts and our minds this day, that we may hear your voice and know your will for each of our lives. Amen. Has anyone ever accused you of being salty? Would you say that you've been salty? Do you even know what it means to be salty? I love a good salty snack. As a matter of fact, since I've been gluten-free, I am severely limited on the junk food that I can eat. So, when I open up a bag of chips, that's it. Which is why we now buy the individual bags of chips that are supposed to go in lunch boxes for my house. Because otherwise, I will eat a family-sized bag of chips in an afternoon if it's raining and gray outside. So these days, you might hear a conversation about being salty. And it is a slang term to describe someone who is angry or agitated or upset or even a little sarcastic. Someone who might be on the attack a little bit. The Urban Dictionary, which is a crowdsourced dictionary for slang terms, and the older I get, the more I have to use it to understand what my teenager is saying, defines salty as the act of being upset or angry or bitter as a result of being made fun of or embarrassed. We all get a little salty, right? Here's just a few examples. Have you ever been sitting in class and you raise your hand and you know that you know the answer, but then you say it and it's completely wrong and you're completely embarrassed? And worse yet, someone you like don't like actually knows the answer? I am a Philadelphia Eagles fan. We spend a lot of time being salty about referee calls and game scores and coaching. Has it ever been when your husband or wife and you are having an argument, usually about something completely stupid, like the name of an actor in a movie or a location of a place, and you know that you know that you're right, and then they Google it and you are in fact wrong? You might be salty. I could go on, friends, but I wonder, have you been salty? Let's just assume yes. Because, well, we've all been embarrassed or angry or annoyed or upset. And many of us have had days when we're mean or annoying or sarcastic, and we're not the most fun person to be around. Here's the thing, we are all salty. But Jesus turns this term salty on its head. And I think we need to reclaim that definition and reframe our understanding and maybe use a little bit of that stained glass language, and we can redeem the word salty. So salt is used time and again in Scripture. Ezekiel describes rubbing the umbilical cord of newborns with salt as part of their care. It's kind of like a loofah to deter bacteria from growing. Leviticus tells us every offering of your grain offering shall be seasoned with salt. You shall not allow the salt of the covenant of your God to be lacking from your offering. With all your offerings, you shall offer salt. Salt was even added to the incense that was used in daily worship in the temple during the Bible. It is critical in the day-to-day life of humanity. Margaret Feinberg, as she so aptly does, gives us a little history of salt in an interesting way. And something that I learned this week when reading this book was that ancient Egyptians were the first to discover salt as an ingredient for food. The evaporated water from the Nile Delta created layers of white granules that they added to meat or fish. In the process, they stumbled upon salt's ability to deter bacteria growth. The invention of curing allowed year-round preservation in food in a time there was just no refrigerators. As time went on, Romans built the Via Salaria, or Salt Road, which became one of their trade routes and expanded their empire. Also, as soldiers were sent to war, they had to walk miles and miles and miles at the time, and it was hot, and they were wearing armor, and they were sweaty. As Amelia pointed out to us this morning, we need salt to live. And so when they became salt deprived, it could start to cause confusion and seizures. A lack of salt can actually cause brain damage. As a matter of fact, I once knew someone that had so little salt in their body, their core temperature had gotten too high, and they began to sweat so profusely that it actually can shut down their organs. It's awful. This is why the Romans started putting salt as part of their soldiers' pay. And it's actually where we get the word salary from, although I don't think any of us would particularly want to be paid in salt today. And then there's this episode in 2 Kings. Elisha has just taken the mantle of leadership from Elijah. He is the new prophet, and his first act is to bring healing and a fresh start to the people of Jericho. You see, their water was making them sick. It wasn't only making them sick, but it was causing women to lose pregnancies. So not only were some of their people dying, but there was no new life. And here you have Elijah adding salt into the spring. And that was able to make the water drinkable. Salt was the answer. Actually, when you visit Jericho now, you can visit Elijah's spring still. People come with bottles to fill with water, and it is rumored that it has healing properties. So we come to today's reading. Jesus, you are the salt of the earth. Don't lose your saltiness. So think about that for a minute in the context of what we said about Roman soldiers who were contemporaries of Jesus, that if they didn't have enough salt, it would start out with them being confused and disoriented and lead to them getting sick and maybe even death. If we lose our saltiness, we are confused. We are called to be salt in a confused, sick, broken world. We are called to be the thing, the tiny little thing, the thing we don't even really give a second thought to most of the time. I mean, half of us, when we cook, throw salt right over our shoulder and onto the floor. We are called that Lee, that little tiny thing that is also life-giving and essential. Being salty is the work that we are called to participate in with God and for others as we grow closer to God through Jesus. In the chapter, Margaret Feinberg says, in essence, Jesus is telling his disciples and us today that we are agents of preserving. God has placed us in this culture, in this time, in this moment, in this slice of history to preserve the ways, the teaching, the life, the power and presence of Christ in the world. We are agents of preserving. We are the ones called to keep the teachings of Christ. Now, that doesn't mean to keep the teachings of Christ to ourselves. We are called to keep the teachings of Christ within ourselves, within our hearts. So what did Christ teach? Love the Lord with all your God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourselves. He taught us to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. He taught us to love the stranger. He taught us to welcome the prodigal son home. What are the teachings of Christ? Love and grace. We are to preserve love. We are to preserve grace. We are to preserve the fruits of the spirits in a midst of a society that is bent towards being angry, agitated, upset, mean, annoying, sarcastic, right? We also know that salt does more than just preserve. As Pastor Jim pointed out in the children's message, it unlocks the flavor, creating delicious dishes for people to feast on. It brings out the taste. So we are being salty. We are unlocking the flavor. We're unlocking the joy in the world. You see, salt brings out the best of food, and Christ brings out the best of us. Have you ever made a dish, usually a dish that has to go in the oven because you can't go back and fix it, and forgotten to put any salt in there? And then it tastes like nothing? You see, salt brings flavor. Salt opens up things and allows them to bloom. In the summer, I love tomatoes. Not those terrible winter tomatoes that we get from the grocery store that are green and yucky, and I wonder why I paid money for them. But you know those tomatoes that you get in the summer that are bright red, and you cut them open and they're delicious. But then you put just a little bit of salt on your slice of tomato, and it's almost a revelation. Salt allows things that are already created and designed by God to be wonderful, to bloom, to grow. We are already created. We are already designed by God to be wonderful, to be the image of God. That salt, those teachings of Christ, they allow us to bloom. Mother Teresa said, not all of us can do great things, but we can all do small things with great love. A couple little kernels of salt, sodium chloride, can make all the difference. If you remember last week, we talked about the gardener that put manure around the tree because it wasn't producing any fruit. And today, one of the other things I learned is that fertilizer salt actually helps it do its job. Margaret Feinberg writes, "Sometimes the places we find ourselves in feel like manure. The last place, the last people, the last situations we want to engage in. We might be tempted to resist the hardship, the discomfort, the awkwardness, the stinkiness, and stay in our comfort zone." But you see, Jesus knew that the world was broken. Jesus lived in the world. Jesus would go on to be crucified by the world. Jesus saw us in this manure. Jesus saw us in our saltiness of being angry and embarrassed and upset. It stunk. You and I, sometimes we can stink. And then Jesus came for us. Jesus broke down our junk so that we could better absorb the fullness of his love. Jesus, friends, Jesus came as salt for us. Jesus came so that we could taste and see that the Lord is in fact good, so that we can become more of what we were meant to be. Bringing us into fullness, bringing out the best of us, loving us so fully that we can make the world taste better. I am here to tell you today, the world is hungry. The world is hungry, and they can tell. They can tell when you've made that dish that has no salt. They can tell that it doesn't taste right, that it's not real. They need salt. They need Jesus. Be salty. Bring the message of Jesus. Bring the love and joy and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and self-control. When we are the salt, when we go out in the world with the full flavor of who God created us to be and the salt that Jesus brings that allows us to bloom, then our whole world can taste and see the kingdom of God right along with us. Let us pray. Lord our God, we thank you. We thank you for the message of Jesus, for the love and grace and peace and joy that Jesus has brought to us. Lord, help us to go out into the world and bring not just the flavors that you have given to us, but that extra pinch of salt that is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, if you would please stand in body or in spirit, we are going to sing number 186 in our hymnal.
Hallelujah.
Please be seated. Interesting. Thank you, those of you who worshiped with us online. May you truly have a blessed week.